Hello everyone. Today we are going to discuss about lumbar vertebrae. Now we know there are total 5 lumbar vertebrae, and out of the 5, L1 to L4 are typical and the 5th one is atypical. Now before starting detailed description of a typical lumbar vertebrae, let me just compare a typical lumbar vertebrae with a typical thoracic and a typical cervical. Now this is a typical thoracic vertebrae, and you just see the shape of the body of both. Over here it is heart shape, over here it is reniform. Overall size is more, it is bulkier, the lumbar one. And additionally you will find costal facets in thoracic vertebrae, right, along their transverse processes and along the body, which is absent over here in case of lumbar. Similarly, when you compare it with the typical cervical vertebrae, just see the overall size. Again, the lumbar one is very bulkier. The foramen transversorium, which is a characteristic feature of a cervical vertebrae, which are found in the transverse processes, they are again absent over here. Similarly, you may find, or generally you find, bifid spine in cervical, and over here it is club shaped, it is quadrilateral plate. So by this you can easily identify a given vertebrae as a lumbar vertebrae. Now let's just start detailed description of a typical lumbar vertebrae. Now first comes the body. As I mentioned, the body is massive and reniform. The transverse diameter is more as compared to anteroposterior diameter. You can clearly make out over here. And they are constricted in front and at the sides. So if you see them from side, you can see the anterior constriction. Similarly, they are also constricted from sides. So if you see them from in front, you can clearly make out the side constrictions. Okay. Now the size of the body will increase from above downward, from L1 to L5. So if you see an articulated spine, you can clearly make out that how the body will increase in size. So let me show you an articulated spine. Over here you can see, this is an articulated spine and this is sacrum. So from below upward, if you count, this one will be L5, L4, L3, L2 and L1, right? So just compare the size of the body. So they are increasing in the size. Okay, see this. Now when you see an individual vertebra from side, you can clearly make out the length of the body is slightly greater anteriorly as compared to the posterior part, right? And so as this will contribute the ventral convexity or the lumbar lordosis of the lumbar spine. Now when you see it in an articulated spine, you can clearly make out how the ventral convexity or lumbar lordosis is. Now next to body is a vertebral foramen, which is triangular in shape and it is larger than the thoracic vertebra, but it is smaller than the typical cervical vertebra. Now let me compare it again with the typical thoracic vertebra. You can clearly make out the vertebral foramen over here in lumbar vertebra is larger as compared to the typical thoracic vertebra. But if you see it with the typical cervical vertebra, you can make out the vertebral foramen of cervical vertebra is larger than the lumbar vertebra. Now let's see the bony landmarks which will contribute to form vertebral arch. And first comes pedicles. Now pedicles are short, strong, and they are directed backwards. You can see over here, these are the pedicles which are directed backwards, and they are attached to the body in such a way, if you see them from side, so they are attached more in the upper half of the body as compared to the lower part, and this will lead to deeper inferior intervertebral notch as compared to the shallower superior intervertebral notches. Just see this attachment of the pedicles. Next comes lamina. Over here you can see, and the lamina are short, thick, and they are broad plates. See this. They are directed posteriorly and medially, or you can say they are directed posteromedially, and they will merge and they will form a spine. Now in lumbar vertebrae, the overlapping between the lamina of adjoining vertebra is minimum. You can clearly make out. There is least or minimal possible overlapping between adjacent lumbar vertebrae. That is quite obvious in case of thoracic vertebrae. Now next comes is a spine, which forms a vertical quadrilateral plate, which is blunt, which is club shaped. It is directed almost backward and only slightly downward, which is thickened along its posterior border over here you can see, and along its inferior border also it is thickened. So this is regarding spine. Now next is transverse processes. These are thin and tapering processes which are directed laterally and slightly backwards. The transverse processes which we see in lumbar region, they actually represent costal element and they are homologous with the ribs in thoracic region. So what is the actual transverse process or actual element which represents transverse process is in the form of accessory processes. Now what are accessory processes? The accessory processes are bony elevations found along the posterior-inferior aspect of each transverse processes. You can clearly make out over here. These are accessory processes and they represent the actual transverse process in lumbar region. Now length of transverse processes, they increase from L1 to L3 vertebra and then it decreases. Let me show you the same in articulated spine. So here in this articulated spine you can clearly make out the length of the transverse processes will increase, right, from above downward up to L3 and then it tapers and it decreases. Now when you join L1 to L5 vertebrae, you can clearly make out length of transverse processes will increase from L1 to L3 and then it decreases. Now when you see a transverse process from in front near its lateral end, the anterior surface bears a faint vertical ridge. You can clearly make out over here. Okay. Now next comes is superior articular processes. Now the distance between two superior articular processes is more as compared to the distance between two inferior articular processes. You can clearly make out from behind as well as from in front. See the distance. Okay, so here the distance is more as compared to the inferior one. Now when you see the articular facets in the superior articular process, they are concave, you can clearly make out, and they are directed medially and backward. Now along their posterior border there is a process which is termed as mammillary process. So here you can clearly make out the mammillary processes. Now next is inferior articular processes. As we have discussed, they are situated nearer to each other as compared to the superior articular processes. And looking at the articular facet, over here you can see they are convex and they are directed forward and laterally, right? So the articulation will take place between superior and inferior articular facets like this. See this. So the articular facet of superior articular process is directed medially and backward, and vice versa for the articular facet for the inferior articular process like this. So they will fit like this, and in between over here between the body there will be intervertebral disc. So this is how the articulation will take place between adjacent vertebrae, between the superior and inferior articular facets. So these are the bony features in typical lumbar vertebrae, that is L1 to L4, as they are sharing common features, but as the L5 is having some specific features, it is atypical. The first and foremost distinguishing feature of L5 vertebra is the transverse process. Just compare transverse process of L5 with the typical lumbar vertebra and you can clearly make out the transverse processes are thick, they are short, they are pyramidal in shape. And the transverse, the base of the pyramid, right, as they are pyramidal in shape, the base will also encroach to the side of the body, which is not in the case of transverse processes of typical lumbar, right. So with that, you can clearly identify it as L5. Another important point is the spine. You can see over here, the spine is small, it is short, it is least substantial. See the size of the spine of a typical and just compare it, right? It is small, short, least substantial, and it is rounded at the tip, whereas over here it is blunt and it has got a typical posterior border. When you see articulated spine, this one is L4, L5 and S1, right? And if you see it behind, these are the spines, and this will be the spine of L4, spine of L5 and this will be the spine of S1, right? Now, just because of formation of lumbosacral angle, the spines are oriented in such a way that the space is very limited between the spines of L4 and S1. And obviously, to get accommodated into that small area, the spine of L5 is very small. Now, third is body, which is largest out of all five lumbar vertebrae. So that will also help you in identification of L5. And if you see it from side, the height of anterior surface, over here you can see it is more as compared to its height along the posterior surface. So here the height is more, and this will contribute to formation of a prominent lumbosacral angle. Let me show you articulated spine, and in that you can clearly make out how this lumbosacral angle is formed. So here you can see the height is more, and there is a backward inclination of sacrum, and over here there is formation of lumbosacral angle, which is in an average 120 degrees. Lastly, the articular processes. Now just see the distance between two superior and two inferior articular processes. They are almost same, you can see over here, or sometimes the distance between two inferior articular processes is more as compared to two superior articular processes. So that is just opposite to what we have discussed in case of typical lumbar vertebrae. See this. Over here, the distance is more between two superior articular processes, and the distance is less. And just compare it with the distance between two superior and two inferior articular processes. Right. So this is very important distinguishing point. Now regarding articular facet, it is directed more of backward than medially in case of superior. Similarly, in case of inferior articular process, the articular facet is directed more of forward as compared to the lateral direction. So facets are directed more backward in case of superior and more forward in case of inferior articular processes. So with these points, you can clearly identify it as an atypical or L5 lumbar vertebra. Now there is one rule termed as Fawcett's rule, which will help you in identification of number of given lumbar vertebrae. Now as per this rule, what you need to do is you'll have to see any given lumbar vertebrae from behind, and you'll have to join the four articular processes, two superior and two inferior, right? And you'll have to imagine a shape. So in case of L5, the imaginary shape will become horizontal rectangle. Over here you can clearly make out, while joining these four, it will become a horizontal rectangle. So that will be L5. Similarly, in case of L4, it will become a square. Let me show you L4. See over here, this is L4. And you can clearly imagine formation of square over here. So this will be L4. Similarly, L3 will form a vertical rectangle. Let me show you. L3, over here you can imagine a vertical rectangle, right? And as the distance between two superior and two inferior articular processes is different, right? So the distance is more in case of superior articular process as compared to inferior one. It will become a trapezium in shape for L1 and L2. You can clearly make out over here. See this? So this can be L1 or L2, right? So according to the shapes formed, you can clearly identify or determine number of given lumbar vertebrae. Now this is termed as Fawcett's rule. So this is about bony features of the lumbar vertebrae. Now let's see attachments. Now looking at the attachments in this diagram, you can see over here the body, its superior and inferior surface will be related to intervertebral disc, whereas anteriorly along its upper and lower border, see over here, along its upper and lower border anteriorly, there will be attachment of anterior longitudinal ligament. Similarly, posteriorly, upper and lower borders will provide attachment to posterior longitudinal ligaments. Now, on either side of attachment of the anterior longitudinal ligament, along the right side, there will be attachment of right cross of the diaphragm along the L1 to L3 vertebrae. Whereas on the left side of the attachment of anterior longitudinal ligament over here, along the L1 and L2 vertebrae only, there will be attachment of left cross of diaphragm. Still next to the attachment of crura, along the upper and lower borders throughout L1 to L5, there will be attachment of psoas major muscle. So here you can see from L1 to L5, the upper and lower borders next to the attachment of crura. Over here, it will provide attachment to psoas major muscle, right? And the attachment takes place in the form of fleshy slips, and in between these fleshy slips, there is formation of a tendineous arches. Now, these tendineous arches will leave some gap between the body of vertebrae and tendineous arches, and that will allow passage of greater MI communicants from the sympathetic chain and lumbar vessels. Now, looking at the attachments along the transverse processes, we have discussed that along the anterior surface of transverse process, there is a faint vertical ridge. Now, over here you can see it will provide attachment to anterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia, right? The thoracolumbar fascia has got three layers, anterior, middle and posterior. So, out of these three, the anterior layer is attached to this vertical ridge. Now, medial to that vertical ridge throughout L1 to L5 will provide attachment to psoas major. So, psoas major muscle will take origin from body, side of the body, as well as anterior aspect of transverse processes of all lumbar vertebrae. Next to that, or deep to the anterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia, there is attachment of quadratus lumborum. Now, next to it will be the tip, and tip will provide attachment to middle layer of the thoracolumbar fascia. So, basically, quadratus lumborum muscle is enclosed between anterior layer and middle layer of thoracolumbar fascia. Additionally, the tip of transverse process of L1 vertebra, specifically L1, will provide attachment to medial and lateral arcuate ligaments of diaphragm, whereas specifically tip of transverse process of L5 vertebrae, right, it will provide attachment to iliolumbar ligament. Now, lamina will provide attachment to ligamentum flava, which will fill gap between the lamina. Now, posterior to the transverse process on either side of the spinous process, this portion will provide attachment to two main muscles, multifidus and erector spinae. Now, both of these are enclosed deep to the posterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia, which itself is attached to tip of spinous process. So, tip of the spinous process will provide attachment to posterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. Tip of transverse process will provide attachment to middle layer of thoracolumbar fascia, whereas faint vertical ridge along the anterior aspect of transverse process will provide attachment to anterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. So this is how the thoracolumbar fascia is oriented. Now here in another diagram you can see over here, this is a posterior view of lumbar vertebrae, and the two processes that we have discussed, accessory process and mammillary process, right? So, accessory and mammillary processes will provide attachment to medial intertransverse muscle, which is cord-like, whereas the space between adjacent transverse processes, right, consecutive lumbar vertebrae, the space between these two will provide attachment to lateral intertransverse muscle, which is membranous. So, by and large, we can say that intertransverse muscles are two, medial and lateral. The medial is specifically attached to accessory process, to mammillary process, whereas lateral is oriented between the spaces of transverse processes. Similarly, over here you can see ligamentum flava, which are attached to the laminas, and that will fill the gap between the lamina. Now, in another diagram, you can see it shows lateral view of spine providing attachment to two ligaments, interspinous ligament and supraspinous ligament. Similarly, posterior view of spine, and you can see there are two structures, interspinous ligament, and on either side of it there will be interspinous muscles, right? So spine is related to two ligaments, interspinous ligament and supraspinous ligament. Similarly, it is providing attachment to three muscles. One is interspinous muscle, and two we have discussed in previous diagram. Let me show you again. So here you can see, apart from interspinous muscle, the spine is also providing attachment to erector spinae and multifidus. So it is said that the spine is related to three muscles, multifidus, erector spinae and interspinous. It is related to two ligaments, interspinous and supraspinous, and it is providing attachment to one fascia, that is posterior layer of thoracolumbar fascia. Apart from this, the mammillary processes will also provide attachment to multifidus, right? This multifidus will also attach to the mammillary processes. So this is regarding attachments along the lumbar vertebrae. Now, when you connect adjacent lumbar vertebrae along their superior and inferior articular processes like this, right, and in between the body over here, there will be intervertebral disc, and you can see over here there is formation of intervertebral foramen. Okay, and as you know, the articular facets are reciprocally concave or convex. So when you join these two, it will permit slight rotation plus flexion and extension. So this is regarding general features and attachments on the lumbar vertebrae. Hope you have understood well. Thanks for watching.